For many years, there was an ongoing dispute about who should be responsible to iterate through a collection. The collection itself, or some external object, what we call an iterator nowadays. Both approaches had their pros and cons, but one day the dispute was over. By imperial decree, only the iterator has remained. Why was that so? It was because the iterator design pattern had an ultimate benefit. The iterator is abstract. It doesn't depend on any concrete collection, even to the point where a collection ceases to exist. The yield return, yes. In this demonstration, I will show you the small print of the iterator design pattern in C#. In .NET, we call iterators the enumerators, and the story of enumerators begins here. An object of this class is wrapping multiple instances implementing the IDiscount interface. You don't need to know the details of the model, just focus on the fact that there are many of them. The purpose of this class, which is implementing the composite design pattern, is to just join the results produced by multiple other objects implementing the same interface. How shall we do that? Of course, by using the iterator design pattern. We normally use the for each loop for that purpose. This will give us access to every item in a sequence, I won't say a collection, but a sequence of objects, so that we can use the loop variable to do whatever we want it to do. In particular, this implementation should join the results produced by many other objects, and each object might produce many results itself. We could accomplish that task by accumulating the incoming objects into a list, using the add range, and then returning the entire list as the result of this method. This is a naive implementation based on consuming the iterator design pattern. Iterator pattern in .NET goes far beyond for each and lists. For one thing, we don't have to maintain a collection if we want to return many objects. We can return a dynamically or even lazily generated sequence of objects. Here we can use the yield return instead to return one item at a time, and the compiler will generate the iterator implementation for us behind the scenes. This was the first giant improvement of iterators in .NET. It was .NET 2.0. And we have enjoyed the benefits of lazy evaluated sequences with the yield return for many years back. And then there was another giant leap just after this one. Enter .NET 3 with lambdas, extension methods, expression trees, a lot of complexity behind, and LINQ. LINQ is all about iterators. Instead of a loop, we use an operator to iterate the items, the operator like select. If you need two nested loops, as we did in that manual implementation of the iterator, then you might opt to use the select many operator instead. This single line of code is doing everything those two nested for each loops did before. As I said, that was the giant leap forward when LINQ came to existence in .NET. And as I said, it was all about iterators. It is removing the need to iterate manually through sequences and collections in so many useful cases. What do you think about this implementation? Do you use LINQ in your designs? I know of many programmers who are still evading LINQ for the reasons which I don't understand. LINQ is the ultimate consumer of iterators. In .NET, whenever you need an iterator, LINQ is a viable candidate to consider to implement a method. And if you agree with me, please press the like button on this video, thank you. I will now show you more of the iterator. I have a more complicated example awaiting. This is another implementation of the IDiscount interface, which wraps two other instances. This rule says that if One discount applies, then return its result. But if it didn't apply, if it returned an empty sequence as the result, then apply the alternate discount and return whatever it returns. A naive solution would be to pick the first one, ask if there is any result in it, and then return it. Otherwise, return the second result, the product of the second object. But this is wrong. You will see it in a minute. There are two iterations over the first IEnumerable here. You don't know if that will work. There are many cases where you are not allowed to iterate twice through the same IEnumerable in .NET. The interface does not communicate that all too clearly, I think, but there is always a danger if you try to iterate the same IEnumerable twice, the danger that that operation will either fail or produce the wrong information without failing, or just produce the right information but with a performance penalty. You don't want any of these in your code. If the IEnumerable is coming from the database, for example, then iterating again might trigger the second query to fetch the data again. If the data are consumed destructively from the data source, then there is no point in trying to iterate twice through the same IEnumerable, because the data from the first iteration don't even exist anymore. That is the case with sockets, for example. When you pull the data through the socket, then those data don't exist anymore and you cannot iterate again through them. We'll get to that in a minute. You will see how that works under the hood. By the way, if you want to see the source code from this demonstration, you can join the growing community on my Patreon page and get access to the source code for this video and all other videos. Let's step to the implementation now and you will see the troubles that we normally face when we use the IEnumerable in .NET. This is the first IEnumerable, the IEnumerable produced by the first contained object. But that is still not the iterator. Maybe the data are not there yet. They will be after we get the enumerator. Now, this is the iterator for that sequence. But an important detail in .NET, enumerators are disposable. We must dispose of an enumerator. And then there comes the gray area of iterators in .NET. This iterator, the enumerator in .NET terms, might cause side effects in the IEnumerable, in the sequence itself. It might destroy its data while iterating them. Well, that is the danger of iterators in .NET. And that's why you must not use the IEnumerable twice unless you know positively that the data will not be destroyed and that the underlying whatever collection or anything supports multiple iterations that will return the same result every time. We must be witty here. We must do everything this method must do in a single pass for the IEnumerable. So I will capture the first item, and if successful, that will be the indication that the primary object, the primary discount, wins in this operation. I will make sure to yield return that item I captured, but also I must not stop. I will keep forward until the end of the iterator and return all other items too. Finally, I must not forget to terminate the output sequence by using the yield break instruction. Otherwise, if this if block didn't execute, then the second, the alternate object must be the winner. It would be nice if we could return its sequence, but it's not possible. Once yield return is used in a method, no other way of constructing a sequence can be mixed together. Everything else must be done through another yield return. So if I use the for each once more, I will be able to yield return all the items produced by the alternate object and the method would be complete. And this method here, It shows it all. We have two ways of consuming the IEnumerable in .NET, either via the IEnumerator, which is a low-level access to a sequence of objects, and we use it when we must, when we have some fine-grained logic on separate individual items in the sequence. The other, coarser-grained but very effective, short and easy method of iterating is the for each loop, of course. And this method is also showing you the two ways .NET supports to support the iterator. One is through returning the IEnumerable or an object that implements it. So this method, the get discount amounts here, is returning an IEnumerable. And the other way of constructing or supporting the iterator is through yield return, where the compiler will construct an entire class for us, a state machine, which will look like an implementation of the iterator design pattern to its ultimate caller. These are all the shades of iterators in .NET. Use them right. Use them where appropriate. And you will benefit from these designs, of course. Don't forget to join the sponsors of this channel at Patreon and to download the source code for this video. Thank you for staying with me, and see you in the next episode.